Good morning, students. The topic for today's discussion is legislative measures for tackling juvenile delinquency. Under this topic, we are going to discuss about a very important legislation, the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. The first legislation which specifically dealt with juvenile offenders and juvenile justice in India was Juvenile Justice Act of 1986. This act was enacted after repealing the Children Act of 1960, which was a general legislation relating to children. The Juvenile Justice Act of 1986 was a comprehensive legislation on juvenile justice. It came into existence to give effect to the provisions of United Nations Declaration of the Rights of the Child in 1959. The Juvenile Justice Act 1986 provided for the uniform law for juvenile justice. It made provisions for establishment of infrastructure and authorities for juvenile justice. It also made provisions for investigation, adjudication, and rehabilitation of juvenile delinquents. But this act too was repealed in 2000. And a new act came in its place, that was the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2000. This 2000 Act was also subsequently repealed, and in its place now we have the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. Now let us see important features of the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. This act relates to children who are alleged to be in conflict with law and children in need of care and protection. It caters to the basic needs of these children through proper care, protection, development, treatment, and social integration. While doing this, the act requires to adopt a child-friendly approach in adjudication and in disposal of matters. The main important feature of this act is that it provides for facilitating the best interest of children. It provides for their rehabilitation through various processes and institutions established under the act. This act relates to two categories of juveniles. Firstly, the child in conflict with law, and secondly, child in need of care and protection. A child in conflict with law is a child who is alleged or found to have committed any offense and has not completed 18 years of age on the date of commission of offense. Whereas child in need of care and protection includes all the children who are victimized. They are injured or exploited, abused, neglected, they are mentally or physically weak, or they are begging, they are runaway children, or they are victims of sexual abuse or armed conflicts, and so on. So child in need of care and protection will include all the children who are victims of the circumstances, whereas child in conflict with law will include the children who are involved in some sort of offenses or antisocial behavior. The Act provides 16 such fundamental principles which are to be followed by the agencies while implementing this Act. So let us see one by one what are these principles. The first principle is principle of presumption of innocence. According to this principle, every child has to be presumed to be innocent of any criminal intent or any malified intent up to the age of 18 years, which means that every child who's a juvenile who's below age of 18 years will be considered to have no malified or criminal intent. That means no mens rea. The second principle is principle of dignity and worth. According to this principle, All human beings shall be treated with equal dignity and rights. This is applicable even to children. Every child, whether it is child in conflict with law or child in need of care and protection, has to be treated with dignity and worth by all the agencies who are dealing with that child. The third principle is principle of participation. Every child has right to be heard and to participate in all the processes and decisions which affect his interest. The views of the child has to be taken into consideration with due regard to the age and maturity of the child. The fourth principle is principle of best interest. This principle is based on the fundamental notion that all decisions regarding the child shall be based on the primary consideration that they are in best interest of the child and to help the child to develop full potential. The next principle is principle of family responsibility. According to this principle, the primary responsibility of care, nurture, and protection of child is that of the biological family or adoptive or foster parents. The sixth principle is principle of safety. This principle requires the authorities to ensure that child is safe and is not subjected to any abuse or maltreatment or harm during the time when it is in the custody of any care or protection system and even thereafter. The next principle is positive measures. The Act requires that all the resources of the state and those of family and community are to be mobilized for promoting well-being of the child and facilitating development of identity and providing an inclusive and enabling environment to the child, whereby the child's vulnerabilities will be reduced and there will be less need for intervention under this Act. Another significant principle under the Act is principle of non-stigmatizing semantics, which requires that during any of the processes pertaining to a child, no adversarial or accusatory words should be used, which can be stigmatizing to the child. The next principle is principle of non-waiver of rights. The Act does not allow waiver of any right of the child, whether sought by the child or person acting on behalf of the child or a board or a committee. It also provides that non-exercise of fundamental right shall not amount to waiver. The Act also provides for principle of equality and non-discrimination, which requires that there shall be no discrimination against a child on any grounds, including sex, caste, ethnicity, place of birth, disability, and equality of access, opportunity, and treatment shall be provided to every child. The right of privacy and confidentiality of a child is also protected by the Act by providing the principle of right to privacy and confidentiality. This principle requires that every child shall have right to protection of his privacy and confidentiality by all means and throughout the judicial process. The next principle is principle of institutionalization as a measure of last resort. If Juvenile Justice Board finds any child in conflict with law, the child is placed in institutional care as a step of last resort after making a reasonable inquiry. Instead, the Act provides for alternatives such as admonition or community service or counseling, probation, and so on. Another fundamental principle under the Act is principle of repatriation and restoration. Every child in juvenile justice system shall have right to be reunited with his family at the earliest. He also has a right to be restored to the same socio-economic and cultural status that he was in before coming under the purview of this Act. Unless such restoration and repatriation is not in his best interest. The next principle is principle of fresh start. According to this principle, all past records of any child under the juvenile justice system should be erased except in special circumstances. This principle allows a child to make a fresh start in the community and makes his social reintegration possible. Another principle under the Act is principle of diversion. According to this principle, the authorities should promote other measures for dealing with children in conflict with law without resorting to judicial proceedings, unless it is in the best interest of the child or the society as a whole. The last fundamental principle and the most significant one is principles of natural justice. The basic procedural standards of fairness shall be adhered to, including right of fair hearing, rule against bias, and the right to review by all the bodies, all the persons, and all the authorities acting in judicial capacity under the Act. Thus, the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015 provides the 16 fundamental principles which are to be compulsorily adhered to by all the authorities, government bodies, and agencies who come in contact with the children and deal with children in conflict with law. Now that we have learned about the fundamental principles which should be followed by all the authorities while dealing with children in conflict with law, let us move on to some important authorities established under the Act. The most important and fundamental authority under the Juvenile Justice Act of 2015 is Juvenile Justice Board. So let us see the organization and functioning of Juvenile Justice Board. The Juvenile Justice Board has to be constituted by state government for every district. Every bench of Juvenile Justice Board shall consist of Metropolitan Magistrate or Judicial Magistrate First Class, not being Chief Metropolitan Magistrate, or Chief Judicial Magistrate with at least 3 years of experience. In addition to this, the bench should also comprise of 2 social workers, of whom at least one should be woman. To be appointed as a member of Juvenile Justice Board, the social worker must have actively involved in the health, education, or welfare activities relating to children for at least 7 years, or must be a practicing professional with a degree in child psychology, psychiatry, sociology, or law. This bench of Juvenile Justice Board have same powers which are conferred by Criminal Procedure Code on Metropolitan Magistrate or a Judicial Magistrate First Class. Any person cannot be selected as a member of Juvenile Justice Board if he has certain disqualifications. The Act provides for 4 such disqualifications. Firstly, if that person has any past record of violation of human rights or child rights. Secondly, the person will be disqualified if he has been convicted of an offense involving moral turpitude and the conviction is not reversed or pardoned. Thirdly, if the person has been removed or dismissed from service of central government or state government or an undertaking or corporation owned or controlled by central or state government. And fourthly, if that person has ever indulged in child abuse or employment of child labor or any other violation of human rights or immoral act. A person who is already appointed as a member of Juvenile Justice Board may be terminated after holding inquiry by the state government on certain grounds. The first ground for termination is that if the person is guilty of misuse of powers which are granted by the Act. Secondly, if that person fails to attend proceedings of the board consecutively for 3 months without any valid reasons. Thirdly, if a member of the board fails to attend 3/4 of sitting of the board for the year, he will be disqualified. And fourthly, if the member is ineligible due to any of the disqualifications. The term of office and of the members will be prescribed by the rules made by the government. In the next lecture, we will see the powers and functions of Juvenile Justice Board.